Hi everyone, and welcome back to Long COVID on the Short, where today we're going to be talking about vascular and endothelial dysfunction. So I think most people know what blood vessels are. They carry blood throughout our body, all the way from the heart to our tissues. And as they get further away from the heart, they start getting thinner and thinner. And then in the returning path back to the heart, they start getting wider again. Now, what people might know less about, and is an important topic for today, is what exactly is the endothelium? The endothelium is the layer of cells that lines the inside of your blood vessels, and it's actually only through the endothelium that the blood vessels can transfer oxygen and nutrients from the blood to the surrounding tissue. And for example, the endothelium also has other functions like contracting and dilating blood vessels. It's crucial to have a healthy endothelium so that your tissues are actually receiving the correct supply of whatever they need to survive. And we know that a dysfunctional endothelium is present, for example, in diseases like atherosclerosis, coagulation disorders, and can even be responsible for heart attacks. So the first step of today's video is to discuss whether COVID can affect directly or indirectly our blood vessels and the endothelium. To exemplify, I'm going to show you two CT scans of the lungs of a patient that has acute respiratory syndrome caused by COVID. Now, pneumonia is an inflammation of the air sacs in the lungs, but COVID's acute respiratory syndrome, on the other hand, is that, plus damage to the endothelium of the very small blood vessels of the lungs. And this causes them to become inflamed, leaky, and overall very dysfunctional. Just for reference, this is 9 times more likely to happen with COVID than, for example, with the flu. But it's not just in the lungs that COVID affects the blood vessels. We had early evidence in people that died with COVID-19, but with minimal lung involvement, that there was actually widespread microvascular damage in the brain. In fact, one autopsy study showed that COVID has the capacity to damage the endothelium of the blood vessels in the brain, and that sometimes that damage is so widespread that they found a significant amount of blood vessels with no endothelium in the brains of people who died with COVID-19. This basically means that those blood vessels were dead. They couldn't function anymore because they had no endothelium. So we've established that COVID-19 can affect directly or indirectly our vascular and endothelial function, actually in a way much more intense than what viruses like the flu do. So the big question of today's video is, could some sort of vascular or endothelial dysfunction persist and create the symptoms we see in long COVID? Remember how I told you that blood vessels get thinner as they get away from the heart and get closer to the tissues that they actually need to irrigate? Well, this is exactly where the problem is. A compelling piece of evidence comes from a study that compared densities of different sizes of blood vessels in patients with long COVID against healthy individuals, but also people that were undergoing the acute phase of COVID. This study showed that patients undergoing the acute phase of COVID as compared to healthy individuals had a reduction in the density of these very small blood vessels, the ones that actually irrigate the tissue. But what is even more interesting for us is that they found that patients with long COVID have a comparable reduction in the density of these very small blood vessels as well. This means that in patients with long COVID, some who had COVID 18 months before the study started, we still see this type of deficit in them that is seen in the patients that have acute COVID. For some reason, a portion of these very small blood vessels died during the acute phase of COVID, and it was never replaced in patients with long COVID. Or perhaps it keeps being replaced and dying out for whatever reason. This is huge because this actually means that your tissues are not getting the adequate amounts of oxygen and nutrients that they need to function properly. I'm certain that you can imagine how this could lead to the severe exhaustion reported by some long COVID patients, but even more, why the symptoms are so widespread. It's basically because if this is one of the root problems, the blood transportation system, our blood vessels, are everywhere. And hence, if there is a problem there, symptoms and other problems can appear in any other part of your body and in any organ. Now, what could actually be causing this? Blood vessels, and especially the small ones, are one of the most regenerable tissues that we have. For this deficient density of small blood vessels to persist, it's likely that angiogenesis, the process in which new blood vessels are created, is impaired. Indeed, one study published in the Journal of Thrombosis and Hemostasis found that patients had elevated levels of something called von Willebrand factor 6 weeks after infection. While 6 weeks in is still a little bit early for long COVID, this is already important because von Willebrand factor is produced and released when the endothelium is being damaged. And moreover, this protein is also involved in microclot formation that I discussed in my previous video. Another study found disruptions in angiogenesis in patients with long COVID up to 5 months after infection. In particular, it found that two vascular transformation proteins could identify 96% of patients with long COVID as compared to healthy individuals or patients undergoing the acute phase of COVID. The first of these two vascular transformation proteins is something called angiopoietin 1, and this is a protein with vascular protective properties that is found to be increased in patients with long COVID. Now, the authors speculate in the paper that this increase might be a long-term response to damage to the endothelium. The second is called P-selectin, and it's also increased in patients with long COVID. This is a type of protein expressed by damaged endothelium that helps motivate an immune response. I think what's important to retain from this specific study is that these two vascular transformation proteins might have a role as biomarkers for long COVID, but also they both indicate ongoing damage to the endothelium and an attempt by the body to repair that damage. Now, crucially, a recent study from this year has confirmed that many vascular transformation proteins, including angiopoietin 1, are altered in patients with long COVID. What's quite interesting is that this study goes one step further and identifies a protein called hypoxia-inducing factor 1, which seems to be characteristic of the patients with acute COVID that will end up developing long COVID. One thing that I would like to emphasize is that in this study, the authors argue quite strongly that long COVID is actually a vasoproliferative process with major multisystemic consequences. A process that could be initiated by hypoxia during the acute phase of COVID, but that could also just be perpetuated by inflammation, ongoing damage to the endothelium, and also important immune processes. Immune processes that I didn't cover on this video because that's not the topic, but it does seem that natural killer cells might have an important role in this dysfunctional angiogenesis. All right, so that's a wrap for vascular and endothelial dysfunction in long COVID. If you're interested to know the similarities or differences between long COVID and ME/CFS, chronic fatigue syndrome, check out the paper that I'm linking below, where they compare dysfunctional angiogenesis in patients with long COVID and patients with long COVID that have a similar presentation to ME/CFS. As always, I hope that this was informative for you, and if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the comments down below. The truth is, we're actually left with a lot more questions than answers, but that's actually great because that's how science works. Now, on my next videos, we'll finally start talking about autoimmunity, which I'm super excited about because autoimmunity against something called G-protein coupled receptors is a big, big suspect in long COVID and might actually be one of the causes of some of the dysfunctions in angiogenesis and blood vessels that we've been talking about today. So until then, stay safe. And if you're on this boat, I hope your recovery is steady, if not quick. Ciao.